Our next speaker will be Dr. Kukimoto, who will be telling us about a novel method to determine the full genome sequences of HPV16 using full circle PCR followed by deep sequencing.
It's my great honor to speak in the plenary session today. I'll be talking about a new methodology of HPV genetic research using a deep sequencing technology. Here I declare there is no conflict of interest in this study. As you know, HPV has a small circular genome. So genome size is about 8 kilobase pairs, and it's relatively easy to determine the genome sequence by conventional Sanger sequencing. So you may think, why deep sequencing is required for HPV genetic research? I can say one useful application is comprehensive identification of known or unknown HPVs from clinical specimens. For this purpose, a rolling circle amplification has been confirmed and followed by deep sequencing. And you can detect multiple HPV types at the same time without specific sequence information. And the other application is analysis of minor genetic variation in clinical specimen. This is called intratype sequence variation and is very popular for RNA viruses that replicate their genomes by their low fidelity RNA polymerases. And interestingly, it is also observed for DNA viruses such as herpes and EB virus. Furthermore, in this science paper, intratype variations were reported for HPV16 in Xinhua samples, but it's not clear how these intratype variations contribute to HPV carcinogenesis. So our question is, how is the intratype variation in HPV16 genome in clinical specimens? To understand its physiological significance, we need to examine intratype variations in great detail. So we have selected deep sequencing technology because we can get more than a million of sequence data and are able to even a low to analyze even a low level of genetic variations. Here I give you an outline of my talk. First, I'll talk about novel PCR system to amplify the full genome HPV16. Then I'll explain how to do de novo assembly of the full genome HPV16 by deep sequencing. Finally, I'll present some data on mutation and insertion deletion in clinical samples. In most cases of HPV genetic research, we use a conventional PCR, which targets a short region in the HPV genome. But in recent years, novel PCR enzymes have been developed, and they can amplify long DNA of more than 8 kilobase pairs with high fidelity, because we'd like to amplify HPV DNA as long as possible. So we have decided to use one of such polymerases, which is available from a Japanese company. To optimize PCR conditions, we have used a plasmid template and four set primer sets, which contain conserved sequence in the HPV16 genome. As shown here, with these primer sets, the new polymerase nicely amplify long 10 kilobase DNA containing nearly full length HPV16 genome. We happened to find surprising results with this polymerase. When we used a primer set which targets short region in the E1 region, E1 gene, this new polymerase generated long 10 kilobase DNA as well as short DNA. We confirmed the sequence of this DNA, and it was the full genome HPV16. So we conclude the polymerase travels around the circular template and amplify full genome HPV16. And we call this PCR full circle PCR. And importantly, this full circle PCR is applicable to native HPV16 genome in WTF cells and clinical samples, as shown here. Okay, I'll talk about our deep sequencing methodology. Here I show a flow of our deep sequencing procedure. First, we amplify HPV16 DNA by full circle PCR. Then the DNA is purified, fragmented, and converted to a library that is readable for deep sequencers. Sequencing is performed on Illumina MiSeq sequencer. This is a flow diagram of sequence data analysis. We obtain more than a million of sequence data as paired and read sequences. First, we need to construct a consensus reference sequence and by using a program called Abis. Then we trim both ends of sequence reads up to 80 bases and select sequences of high quality score and map all the sequence data to the reference sequence by BWA. These programs are available from websites as free software, so you can use it freely. Here I describe a study subject. We analyze HPV16 genome in W12 cells. W12 cells were originally established from C1 biopsy by Dr. Stanley in 1989. And contain episomal HPV16 genome. Then we apply our analysis to clinical samples collected from SHIN1 patients in Japan, and which had been to be checked to be only HPV16 positive. And these are three samples. And furthermore, we included HPV16 plasmid to estimate background error rate of the system. This is a result of de novo assembly of HPV16 genome of W12 cells. We constructed 7,904 bases sequence, and it's completely matched to the W12 sequence in the GenBank. And no gap or major mutation are found in read mapping, which indicate that our assembly procedure is correct and reliable. This is a result of the clinical samples. So far, six major variants have been identified for HPV16. We obtained two European types and one African type as a single reference sequence for each sample. The differences of genome lengths are due to insertion of T in the poly-A sequence. In the final part of my talk, I'll present data on mutation frequency and insertion deletion in the clinical samples. Here again, a flow diagram of data analysis. To analyze mutation frequency, we pile up bases at each genome position by using some tools and calculate base substitution rates by using our in-house program. This is a mutation frequency profile in W12 cells. As you can see, the mutation pattern is flat, indicating that HPV16 genomes were rather homogeneous in W12 cells. But you can see some mutations. So question arises whether these are true or meaningful mutation frequencies. In deep sequencing analysis, there are two types of error that can lead to false mutations. One is PCR error, and the other is sequencing error. In this case, PCR error is extremely low, so we evaluate sequencing error by analyzing HPV16 plasmid without PCR. In HPV16 plasmid, there are still 0.2 to 3% mutations. So we consider these are background errors in the sequencing system. And we set 0.5% as a cutoff value for meaningful frequency. From this slide, I'll present a mutation profile of three clinical samples. In this sample, there is no significant mutation position detected. In this sample, there is one mutation position detected, which is located in E6 region here. Interestingly, in this sample, we can detect four mutation positions with mutation frequency 0.5 to 2%. Furthermore, we have found deletions in E2 and early poly-A sequences. This is a deleted region in E2. 27 bases are deleted in 80% of total read sequences. The deletion is located in the hinge region in the E2 protein, so it may affect E2 function. This is a deletion in the early poly-A sequences. 63% of total reads were deleted, as shown here. I'll present a summary of mutation and deletion in clinical samples detected by deep sequencing. Overall, HPV16 genomes were rather homogeneous, but some low-level mutations were found depending on samples. These mutations were either silent or non-silent. Let me summarize my talk. We have developed a novel system to analyze genetic variations in the HPV16 genome using deep sequencing technology. By using this system, we have found HPV16 genomes were homogeneous in WTB cells and one SHIM1 samples, but low-level mutations were found and deletion were found in two SHIM1 samples. Of course, we need more data to analyze biological meaning of intertype variation in HPV16. And we are now analyzing more samples of various grades of SHIM1 lesions. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. You can either sit here or go down. We're going to do questions afterwards.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think one of the points that we wanted to make was deep sequencing will now allow us to look at genomic variation at the somatic cell level that were rare beyond what we could normally detect for different genomes. And we just saw an excellent example of the technology and some results.